It was great to hear about UNICEF's commitment to this agenda, and now we're about to hear from our next co-host, the Vice Minister for Foreign Affairs and International Development Cooperation from Italy. Please join me in welcoming Emanuela Claudia Del Rey.
I'm also taking track of my notes because I don't want to exceed the timing, and this is why I will follow some of the thoughts that I want to share with you. Of course, it is a pleasure to be here, and I'm particularly happy because this is the format we want. You know, having the government on one side of the hosting country, and also the activists, very important, young leaders, NGOs, practitioners, we have also the pleasure of having here our Italian Agency for Development Cooperation, just to name a few ministers from other countries. I think that this is really, you know, the kind of approach that we need to address this particular issue of mental health. I have, actually yesterday, many times it has been mentioned that we are celebrating three anniversaries. Probably the most important in this particular moment is the fact that we are celebrating 600 years of the Hospital of Innocenti. But I also want to say that what is coming to my mind, because I have witnessed this particular historical moment, tomorrow is the 30th anniversary of the fall of the Berlin Wall. And the Berlin Wall is not just a symbol of freedom, of change, of many other issues, but in terms of mental health, it made me think of the political use that was made of mental health during the Soviet era. And this is something that unfortunately is still happening in many parts of the world. And this is probably one of another topic that I would like to put on the table of our discussion today. Apart from this, of course, this is the right place to be, because as it has been mentioned already, but maybe for some of you it's good to know, this hospital has been ongoing since 600 years, not just one day. And this is the reason why in 1988, the Italian government, together with UNICEF, decided to use this building as a mandate to contribute to an emerging global ethic for children. And obviously, this has been the start of a long journey, because it later became the UNICEF's Office of Research, an office to which Italy obviously attaches a fundamental importance, because research, as it has been mentioned, is fundamental in many aspects. Data, critical evidence, research, and absolutely fundamental to give us a point of reference and also to enrich our collective work. From data, we start a new research, which is a very important element to think, to keep in mind. I just want to say that I agree with you, Henrietta, because of course in some of our countries we have advanced very much in terms of mental health, although we are not perfect, but definitely there is still very much to do in most part of the world, where mental health corresponds to discrimination, to exclusion, in some cases even to killing, because mentally ill people are considered, let's say, evil. And this is something that we have to keep in mind. We know this is probably the achievement we have gathered so far. We know that mental health is important by many respects. And I think that it is well acquired, the fact that mental health is fundamental for social behavior. And therefore, you have to, in general, put the maximum attention to it, because it enables people to express their full potential. It gives healthy lifestyles, because the mental health, obviously, is related to the communities, not just to individuals. It helps to strive in education, work productively, contribute to, in general, society and the fulfillment of the aspirations, not only of individuals, as I mentioned, but the whole communities. Nevertheless, we know that the situation is still very serious, and this is why we have to insist very much on the nexus between mental health and development, as I just briefly mentioned last night. There are two meanings related to this concept of development. One is certainly the development, as I mentioned, related to development in terms of what you do to allow a society to develop under many different respects. But this is more at community level. Of course, we have another element, which is the element of development of the person. And we know very, very well that developmental psychology is still fundamental. It's little known in many places. You were talking about some models. For instance, in Italy, we have advanced a lot in that sense. I just would like you, because you are in Italy at the moment, ask around about our model for primary schools, for instance, because teachers work on classes, not just on the individuals. So the individual grows within a group, which is absolutely a huge revolution that we have had since 30 years now, but 30 years is not that long in the whole history, but it has made a huge difference. So there is obviously solid evidence that we know the mental health is the product of psychosocial, environmental, biological and genetic factors interacting with neurodevelopmental processes, especially at early stages of our life. We have already heard saying that we need to intervene at early stages. We need to be able to prevent. But this is very difficult because unless you are educated to see, well, we were talking about listening, but also seeing is not easy. Some gestures are, for all of us probably in this room, a clear sign of some, you know, uneasiness, not necessarily of an illness, but uneasiness or discomfort. If you are not educated to see these things, you will just think that those gestures are not in conformity with society, and therefore they are a sign of self-exclusion or a motivation for exclusion. So this is very, very important. We are trying to prevent, especially in early stage. We know that early intervention in the first 1,000 days of life, but I don't need to tell you experts, but just to remind us all, absolutely very important. For instance, breastfeeding. We know that breastfeeding is fundamental because it's a neuro exercise for the child. We know that stimulation under many respects, but also, obviously, going into protection, security, protection including screening of domestic violence and of perinatal depression, improvement of daily living conventions to avoid toxic stress associated to neglect and deprivation within multi-sectoral early child development programs. This is part nowadays of a global awareness, although the challenge is to put it in practice. I just want to share with you a memory of mine, which is quite illuminating. During my long years on field in conflict areas, for instance, I was talking to a child of a friend, of a family, which is a friend of mine, in a refugee camp in Iraq, a Syrian Kurd refugee. And he was telling to me, the thing I miss the most, that makes me seriously sad, and the mother interrupted saying, he's depressed, is the fact that I'm going to school only 1 hour a day. And she said to me, he said, you know, you see my head, you think my brain is very small, but think about a huge storage room. I could store much more information. And if I don't use this, I really feel very sad. Just to give you an example. That is in my mind every single day. I see the happiness of the children going to school in Italy. And I think about those who don't have this opportunity, especially in terms of depression, which is, as we know, transversal to all cultures, to all individuals in the world. So we need to pay special attention to high-risk groups, such as the children victims of violence, abuse, poverty, and obviously, as I mentioned, in conflict areas. But obviously, we have also to think that with 350 million children and adolescents living in conflict areas globally, we need to focus our early actions on especially evidence-based interventions. And this is where our activity today comes into place, because we are gathering information, we are gathering data, we are gathering practices, and we are developing models and patterns and strategies that can be really applied, contextualizing, obviously, the intervention in different areas. We are aware that establishing quality psychosocial services and systems is a long-term commitment. Italy is fully engaged, I just want to tell you, not only because we are cooperating with UNICEF and we are funding together with UNICEF this beautiful conference that I hope will become a tradition of our particular area. But obviously, we say that we consider mental health as part of development, as I mentioned at the beginning. And this is why we support strongly programs that offer mental health and social, psychosocial services, as well as including mental health psychosocial support in multi-sectoral interventions. I'll just give you a couple of examples. For instance, within the Syrian refugee crisis, as well as in Iraq, in the Sahel region, and in the Horn of Africa, Italy has been dedicated specific attention to mental distress to implement the humanitarian development nexus, which is another nexus to which we have to pay attention, especially in the framework of Agenda 2030 that, thank God, was designed, because it gives us a real framework to which we can all make a reference. In Jordan, I mentioned yesterday, we supported the WHO in strengthening the mental health system to improve access and services for Syrian refugees and vulnerable Jordanian population. This approach consists of both strengthening community-based activities, awareness and advocacy, and strengthening comprehensive community-based mental health services at the secondary level of care, including rehabilitation, and downsize standalone psychiatric hospitals. Moreover, last month, we convened in Amman, in partnership with the Jordanian Ministry of Health, the regional conference reinforcing health services and systems for the mental health of children and adolescents, a regional perspective. I want to say that conference aimed at improving mental health services for the youth in Jordan, Palestine, Lebanon, and Iraq by gathering, again, political leaders, scientists, researchers, and employees in the field. I strongly believe that these two conferences perfectly create a complementarity to build solid cases and useful policy recommendations. I think that we should link all these activities. This would also be very interesting to map all the activities that we are all organizing. I'm just going to conclude. I want to refer to the five keywords which define the agenda of the conference. Connect, listen, share, discuss, act. Obviously, this conference has a unique potential. It is obvious. I don't think that we need to explore this more. But I just would like to suggest to add empower, as I said last night, because empowering mentally ill people and people with psychosocial disabilities is fundamental. Because if we recognize their capability of being social actors, we also educate their communities to include mental health in the so-called normality of human life. Thank you very much.